other day, I walked into my daughter's room and told my daughters that I had done something wrong. Just over the oven in our house, we've got a cupboard up there, and whenever I see cereal on sale, I get a few boxes. Well, my daughters have accused me of being a hoarder. there's a few boxes up there. There's not that many. Well, the other day I walked into my daughter's room with something behind my back, and I said, "Girls, I have done wrong." And they peeked up and looked at me and said, "Dad, what have you done?" Well, I took out from behind me two boxes of cereal. So anyway, this morning, and the reason I'm sharing that with you is I have another confession to make. I forgot my little pointer, Fernando, this morning. So I need, does somebody have a stick? Okay, there's one back here. Ah, here it is. But Fernando, I know exactly where it is, and I will be bringing it. You got it this one? No, Don, I think I'll use this. Thank you, though. This one's a little bit nicer. That's better. So, anyway, I know where it is, and I'll be getting it back real soon. And I'll be bringing it back here with me. But anyway, let's kneel for prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much today that we can look outside of ourselves and that you can help us to do what we can't do. We're so thankful that you can take our trials and our temptations and you can do for us what we can't do. And we just praise you today for that wonderful, wonderful truth of your saving grace. We pray for the Holy Spirit to guide us today as we see how your grace, how your strength worked in another person's life. We pray for your guidance. May we gain courage and strength as we review what happened in her life today. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, is this on, Jim? Doesn't sound like it is. Testing? Is that on now? Or am I just talking louder? Okay. All right. You know, I think it is now. Seems to be. Thanks, Jimbo. First Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. Beautiful promise in Scripture. As I was sharing last week on the radio program out of Los Angeles on yet another idea that people would use to say that if you don't accept a certain name for God, then you're a lost person, that salvation is somehow found in some issue. You know, folk, I thought about that, and I shared it last Wednesday on the program. What issue could possibly help me to resist temptation? Calling God by a certain name, is that going to help me to resist temptation? It's not going to work, is it, Nellie? How about if I believe in the feast days? Is that idea going to give me the strength to resist something that attacks my mind? Is it? That's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. There is only one being in the universe that can help us to fight the fight of faith, and that's Christ. He is the only one who can do that, and he's so willing to help us. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30, it says, "But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us." Now this is what Christ is for us: wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. "That according as it is written, he that glorieth..." Now where are we going to glory? In ourselves? We're going to glory in the Lord, in Christ himself. You know, yesterday as I was visiting with this man out of New Jersey, he had texted me about 3 weeks ago, and he had one simple question. He said, "What is the everlasting gospel?" And I thought, well, do you want the short version? Or do you want the long version? So I simply said to him, "Call me." Now, folk, if you could, in two sentences, what is the everlasting gospel? How would you answer that? Real simple. Dennis, what would you say? Okay. And what answer was arrived at?
Christ and him being crucified.
Christ and him being crucified. Okay. Excellent. Anybody want to add anything else? Rita. Okay. Christ and him crucified so that we are restored, so that the image of God is restored in us. Okay. Excellent. Any other comments you'd want to add, or was that pretty much, that's pretty much it? Okay. The one other comment that I added from what you guys said was the complete laying of the glory of our glory in the dust. Now that's what I shared with the man yesterday. I said, I'll give you the simple answer first, then I'll give you the longer answer. It's the laying of our glory in the dust where Christ and him alone is glorified. And that basically, Dennis, is what you and Rita were saying. So, let us glory in what Christ has done and what he is willing to do in our behalf today. This morning we're going to look at part 21, the final scenes. She was there too. I guess it could be a few different ladies that were there at the cross. We're going to take a look at one of them today. Sweetie, go ahead. John 19, verses 25 to 27 tells us about her. It says, "Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved..." Now who was the disciple whom Jesus loved? But I thought he loved all of them.
He did.
What does that mean, whom he loved? Why did John say that? Was he being proud? Was he being arrogant? What did he mean? When he called himself the one whom he loved. He was the youngest one. Okay, he definitely was, Dennis. He was closest to Christ, no doubt. What the actual phrase means, it means the one whom Jesus kept on loving in spite of himself. That's what it means. So John was not being proud at all. He was just simply stating that Jesus kept loving him even though he was a son of thunder. So Jesus, Mary is there, John is there. Jesus saith to his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then saith he to the disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. That's pretty amazing, folks, in the amount of suffering that Christ was dealing with there at the cross, that he saw his mother standing there and pinpointed the keen hope that John would take her home and take care of her for the rest of her life. Next slide. Desire of Ages 752 says that he at once took Mary, John did, to his home, and from that hour cared for her tenderly. O pitiful, loving Savior, amid all his physical pain and mental anguish, he had a thoughtful care for his mother. He had no money with which to provide for her comfort, but he was enshrined in the heart of John, and he gave his mother to him as a precious legacy. Thus he provided for her that which she most needed, the tender sympathy of one who loved her because she loved Jesus. And in receiving her as a sacred trust, John was receiving a great blessing. She was a constant reminder of his beloved master. The perfect example of Christ's filial love shines forth with undimmed luster from the midst of ages. For nearly 30 years, Jesus, by his daily toil, helped bear the burdens of the home. And now, even in his last agony, he remembers to provide for his sorrowing, widowed mother. The same spirit will be seen in every disciple of our Lord. Those who follow Christ will feel that it is a part of their religion to respect and provide for their parents. From the heart where his love is cherished, father and mother will never fail of receiving thoughtful care and tender sympathy. What's that, Nellie? He was fulfilling the fifth commandment. That's exactly right. You know, now, you know, as I was reading through that, I thought to myself, well, my, I hope the young people in here are hearing that this morning. Ramanita, are you listening? Tabitha, are you listening? But wait a minute. That's not just for Tabitha and Ramanita. Do I have parents? Well, I have my mother still. Should I not also show her care and compassion? Absolutely. It doesn't matter how old we become. As long as we have parents, we need to show them honor. We need to show them appreciation, no matter who they are. From the heart where his love is cherished, father and mother will never fail of receiving thoughtful care and tender sympathy. Next slide. The mother of Jesus, Desire of Ages 744, supported by John, the beloved disciple, had followed the steps of her son to Calvary. She had seen him fainting under the burden of the cross and had longed to place a supporting hand beneath his wounded head and to bathe that brow which had once been pillowed upon her bosom. But she was not permitted this mournful privilege. With the disciples, she still cherished the hope that Jesus would manifest his power and deliver himself from his enemies. Isn't that amazing what happens when we have a wrong belief? Even as Mary watched Jesus being raised up on the cross, she was hoping that he would break himself free and prove to be the Messiah. Why did she believe that? All the Jews did, didn't they, Reggie? Not just Mary had a wrong concept, but all Israel had been taught to believe this wrong idea concerning the Messiah. Even though Jesus had taught them the exact opposite, Nellie, that's right. The enemy did a super job, Reggie. Absolutely, did a super job. You know, as I read that this week, I thought, my, is there anything that I'm believing that I cannot support in inspiration? Boy, you know, because look at this, folks. To the very end, Mary was expecting Jesus to manifest his power and deliver himself from his enemies. Again, her heart would sink as she recalled the words in which he had foretold the very scenes that were then taking place. As the thieves were bound to the cross, she looked on with agonizing suspense. Notice what's going on here, folk. Mary knew exactly what Jesus had taught, but the priests and rabbis had said something exactly the opposite. So the control of a false teaching has such power on the human mind. Mary looked on with agonizing suspense. Would he who had given life to the dead suffer himself to be crucified? Would the Son of God suffer himself to be thus cruelly slain? Must she give up her faith that Jesus was the Messiah? Must she witness his shame and sorrow without even the privilege of ministering to him in his distress? She saw his hand stretched upon the cross. The hammer and the nails were brought, and as the spikes were driven through the tender flesh, the heart-stricken disciples bore away from the cruel scene the fainting form of the mother of Jesus. Now, obviously, this statement here, at first when Mary got to the cross and she saw her son being thrust into the ground, she saw him being cruelly mistreated, it was then that Mary fainted. It was then that she was taken away from the cross. But after she was revived, she was then brought back to the cross. And it was then that Jesus pointed to her and said, Mary, John is now your son, and John, Mary is now your mother. So Mary fainted when she first arrived at the cross, but then was brought back later on. Next slide. Well, let's go back for a little bit this morning. Let's take a look at Mary's journey of faith. Of course, Mary's journey of faith started not in Jerusalem, not at Golgotha, but it actually began in the evil town of Nazareth. Mary was just an early teen. Most people will say that young ladies back in that time, if they were not engaged to be married by around somewhere between 12 and 15 years old, if they were not engaged by that time, they were considered to be an old maid. Now, that obviously was a different culture and a different time. But nevertheless, So it's very likely, based on the custom of that time, that Mary was somewhere between 12 and 15 years old when this event took place. Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. Now, the word espoused here simply means, in our vernacular, she was engaged. They were engaged to be married. The angel came to her and said, "Hail, thou art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women." When she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. The angel said to her, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be called great. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest. The Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there shall be no end." Next slide. Then said Mary unto the angel, "How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For with God, nothing shall be impossible." And Mary said, "Behold, the handmaiden of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word." And the angel departed from her. Now, folk, let's think for a moment here. Mary is an early teenager. She is engaged to a man that we know from Mark chapter 6, verses 3 and 4, that has at least six children. Joseph had been married before. Obviously, his first wife had passed away. He had at least six children. There are four boys mentioned in Mark chapter 6, and it says, "And are not also his sisters here with us?" Well, sisters is plural, so Joseph had at least two girls and possibly more than that. So Joseph was quite a bit older than Mary. They had not yet come together in marriage. And when the angel came and said, "Mary, you are going to have a child," Mary said, "That's impossible. I have never been with a man. How can that be," she said, "seeing I know not a man?" Gabriel said, "The Holy Ghost will come upon you. The power of the Highest shall overshadow you. And the child, the holy thing that will be born of you, will be called the Son of God." Now, folk, what were the ramifications if Mary agreed to this? Think about it for a minute. Would there not be any repercussions? Mary was living in a strict Jewish community. Yes, it was known for its evil, but nevertheless, in the synagogue there in Nazareth, Mary obviously was a strict Jewish young lady. Next slide. What were the ramifications? Risky business. If Mary accepted what the angel said, could she not be killed for adultery? She could have been killed for adultery. She could definitely lose her husband-to-be. At the very least, Mary would be ostracized from society. Given all of those things, folk, if we were in Mary's position, how would we have responded? Would we risk death to do what God asks us to do? Would we risk separation from people who we love? Would we risk the possibility of being completely shunned by society? Those were some of the things Mary had to ask herself. Next slide. Matthew chapter 1, verses 19 to 23 tells us that Joseph, obviously when Mary went to Joseph and said, "Joseph, I'm pregnant," Joseph did not believe this idea that some angel had come to her. We know that. Because the Bible says, Joseph, her husband, being a just man, he was a fair man, he was an honest man, he was a God-fearing man, not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately, privily. Joseph said, "Mary, I don't buy this. You've been messing around." He obviously felt that way. But he didn't want to have her humiliated. He most certainly didn't want her to be killed. So Joseph said, "Okay, fine, I'm just going to put her away privately. I'm just going to, you know, kind of sweep it under the rug." Folk, let's get into Joseph and Mary's heartache here for a moment. Joseph, I'm sure, with 6+ children, with the likelihood of having now a devout young woman to share the responsibilities in his home, he's a worker, he's got to provide for his children, but now here's a young lady who agrees to inherit a ready-made home with at least six children, some who were probably close to her age. If Joseph had a calendar on the wall in his carpenter shop, you can be sure that there's a red circle around that date when they're going to actually tie the knot and be married. But you can also see that once he realizes that his bride-to-be has been unfaithful, that he probably tore that page out of his calendar. Joseph was hurt. Mary was hurt. There was deep pain in this experience. And so one day, Joseph probably just aimlessly, you know how it is sometimes when you get so upset and your heart is breaking over a situation that you kind of just do things in a fog. Well, I can picture that one day Joseph was in a fog some Sabbath morning as he got up to go to church, and he kind of just aimlessly kind of walked in, you know, and the rabbi said, "Good morning, Joseph," and he kind of ignored them, didn't even really hear them. And so he makes his way into a seat in the church, and while he was there, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which being interpreted is God with us. I wonder what that reunion of Mary and Joseph must have been like as Joseph goes, you know, comes out of that dream, comes out of hearing the angel speak to him, and he rushes to wherever Mary was, probably secluded in her home somewhere, reading a book, not wanting to be humiliated by the people of Nazareth. And Joseph says, Mary, you were telling me the truth. I believe now. And so the circle goes back on the calendar. Of course, the page was ripped out. He probably had to get a new calendar. Next slide. And so then the 9 months go by. Luke chapter 2, verses 4 through 7. And folk, Joseph believed the story now, doesn't he? But did the people of Nazareth believe the story? They never believed the story. Never believed it. Mary began through that 9 month period to begin to feel some of the ache, some of the pain, some of the trials that God would allow to come into her life to teach her to trust, to teach her to depend upon Him. And it continued. Joseph went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. Because Caesar Augustus had stated that all the world was to be taxed, so Joseph had to go back to the home of his ancestors, which was Bethlehem, and he had to be registered there. To be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, they still had not come together as a couple, living under the same roof. They were still just engaged, being great with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered, and she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. So Jesus was born in a stall where there were animals that were doing what animals do, where animals take care of their needs and where they eat and where they sleep. Mary was beginning to figure out and see that things weren't going to be just exactly as she thought they would. The Messiah was not going to be treated like a king, but that was a lesson that was very difficult for her to understand. Next slide. Mary got a further intimation of the problems, the challenges that she would be called to endure when 8 days or a short time after Jesus' birth in Bethlehem, they went up to Jerusalem to dedicate Jesus. This would have probably been several weeks after Christ's birth. Luke chapter 2, verses 25 to 35 tells us about a man named Simeon. The same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. The Holy Ghost was upon him. It was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law. Then took he him in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people. A light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. Mary was thrilled. Mary was thrilled. My son, he's getting the recognition that he deserves. He is the Messiah. But then Simeon said something that Mary was not real clear about. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, Behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against. Yea, a sword shall pierce through thy own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Mary received an intimation, folk, that bearing the Messiah and raising the Son of God, there was going to be pain. There was going to be pain. Next slide. Desire of Ages, page 56, says that Mary did not understand Christ's mission. Simeon had prophesied of him as a light to lighten the Gentiles, as well as a glory to Israel. Thus the angels had announced the Savior's birth as tidings of joy to all peoples. God was seeking to correct the narrow Jewish conception of the Messiah's work. He desired men to behold him not merely as the deliverer of Israel, but as the redeemer of the world. But many years must pass before even the mother of Jesus would understand his mission. Mary looked forward to the Messiah's reign on David's throne, but she saw not the baptism of suffering by which it must be won. Through Simeon, it is revealed that the Messiah is to have no unobstructed passage through the world. In the words to Mary, a sword shall pierce through thy own soul also. God, in his tender mercy, gives to the mother of Jesus an intimation of the anguish that already for his sake she had begun to bear. Are there any things today that God's professed people have a real, total misunderstanding over? Just as ancient Seventh-day Adventism did? You know, I am continually confronted on these radio programs with people who constantly want to tell me. They say, we've got to stay with the ship. It's going to go through. The Seventh-day Adventist denomination, it's going to go right on through to the promised land. It's a terrible, terrible deception, friends. It's a terrible deception that is amongst us as a people today. Next slide. Of course, after the dedication of Jesus, shortly after that, Herod hears of the wise men. They see Christ. And then it was that Herod, realizing that the wise men had not done as they had promised, had not come back to him and told where the Messiah was, that Herod went about to kill the baby Jesus. So friends, again, we see Mary realizing that her son is not being treated as a king. Her son is being treated as a fugitive. Her son is being treated as worthy of death. So Mary was beginning to realize the pain that would come with having the Son of God. Next slide. But you know, with all the pain that Mary suffered, with all the trials that Mary bore because she accepted Christ as her son, she got to see what nobody has ever seen. Desire of Ages, page 72. She saw a child that was so committed to God and to loving his fellow man. It was beautiful. Desire of Ages, page 68 and 69. Notice this picture. It says, as a child, Jesus manifested a peculiar loveliness of disposition. His willing hands were ever ready to serve others. He manifested a patience that nothing could disturb, and a truthfulness that would never sacrifice integrity. In principle, firm as a rock, his life revealed the grace of unselfish courtesy. Desire of Ages, page 72, says, Jesus lived in a peasant's home and faithfully and cheerfully acted his part in bearing the burdens of the household. He had been the commander of heaven. Angels had delighted to fulfill his word. Now he was a willing servant, a loving, obedient son. He learned a trade and with his own hands worked in the carpenter's shop with Joseph. In the simple garb of a common laborer, he walked the streets of the little town, going to and returning from his humble work. You know, I love these pictures of Jesus. His willing hands were ever ready to serve others. He was a willing servant, a loving, obedient son. He faithfully and cheerfully acted his part in bearing the burdens of the household. You know, those are our duties as well. I know in another page in Desire of Ages, it says that Jesus was just as much doing the work of God as he helped out in his home as when he was preaching on the hillsides of Galilee. You see, folk, the common duties that we have at home, whether it be doing dishes, whether it be washing clothes, whether it be mowing lawns or sweeping the driveway, we all have responsibilities. And we all need to participate willingly in those responsibilities. Jesus was a perfect example, not only in his ministry, but in bearing the burdens of the household. Bearing the burdens of the household. Next slide. Okay, here's the statement. Desire of Ages, page 74. Jesus was the fountain of healing mercy for the world. Through all those secluded years at Nazareth, his life flowed out in currents of sympathy and tenderness. The aged, the sorrowing, the sin burdened, the children at play in their innocent joy, the little creatures of the groves, the patient beasts of burden, all were happier for his presence. He whose word of power upheld the worlds would stoop to relieve a wounded bird. There was nothing beneath his notice, nothing to which he disdained to minister. He was doing God's service just as much when laboring at the carpenter's bench as when working miracles for the multitude. You know, folk, if we're not faithful in the little common duties of life in our homes, how can we ever expect God to ask us to do something greater? We can't. We can't. Because God gives us the simplest of duties to see if we'll be faithful in those duties. And he that is faithful in that which is least is what? Faithful also in much. That's right, Reggie. Faithful also in much. So we need to be diligent and faithful and willing in the simple duties of the household. We all need to do that. We all need to chip in and do our part in lessening the burdens, of the other members of our house. You know, I'll tell you, I know when I come home from work, or if I'm outside and it's 95 degrees out and it's 90% humidity and my clothes have all changed color because I've sweated profusely, and I come into the house and I see the members of my home, I see my wife or my daughters, and they're cleaning the kitchen, or you know, they're vacuuming. I walk in and I hear the vacuum running. You know what that does to me? That encourages me. Because I've been out sweating profusely outside, mowing the yard and, you know, edging it and just dripping wet. When I come inside and I see that they're in there working too, that's an encouragement to my heart. Because I know that they're taking part in helping out as well. But I'll tell you something that's very, it's not disheartening, but it kind of makes me sad. If I walk in after I've been outside sweating and doing outdoor work and I come inside and, you know, the dishes in the sink are, you know, up over my head, or, you know, there's papers and other things all over the floor. Now, I'm not saying that happens, you understand. But if it did, that would make me sad. Because I'm out doing everything I can to make our home nice and presentable, but not everybody else is pitching in. So, folk, it's very, very important that we take up our duties and our responsibilities. Because we all have them. And God requires that we try to lift the burdens of others. Very important. Next slide. Mary watched the unfolding of Christ's power. She saw the King of the universe veiled in the garb of humanity. What a privilege was hers. What a privilege was hers. Because of being his mother, Mary could possibly believe that she had special ties to Jesus. But this was clarified very clearly at the marriage in Cana of Galilee. Let's face it, folks. Mary is working with this young man from the time she gives birth to him. She nurses him. She teaches him at her knee. She is with him all through his young teenage and then into his early adult life. There obviously was a tie there. There was a tie there that only a mother and a child and a son can know. But there had to come a point in time when Mary understood very, very clearly that Jesus was the Messiah and that Mary could be saved in no other way but through faith in Jesus like everyone else. That started to be understood at the marriage in Cana of Galilee, shortly after Jesus began his ministry. Next slide, sweetie. Desire of Ages, page 147. Notice what it says. There was danger that Mary would regard her relationship to Jesus as giving her a special claim upon him. And the right, in some degree, to direct him in his mission. I mean, that's understandable. It's very understandable. For 30 years, he had been to her a loving and obedient son. His love was unchanged. But he must now go about his Father's work. As Son of the Most High and Savior of the world, no earthly ties must hold him from his mission or influence his conduct. He must stand free to do the will of God. This lesson is also for us. The claims of God are paramount even to the ties of human relationship. Friends, when we feel a call from God to do something, when we have talents and abilities that God has given to us to be used in a certain way, we must follow that path. We must follow that path. Christ must stand free to do the will of God. This lesson's for us. The claims of God are paramount even to the ties of human relationship. No earthly attraction should turn our feet from the path in which He bids us walk. The only hope of redemption for our fallen race is in Christ. Mary could find salvation only through the Lamb of God. In herself, she possessed no merit. Her connection with Jesus placed her in no different spiritual relation to Him from that of any other human soul. This is indicated in the Savior's words. He makes clear the distinction between His relation to her as the Son of Man and as the Son of God. The tie of kinship between them in no way placed her on an equality with Him. There are many people today that want to make Mary a co-redemptress, a co-redeemer. That's blasphemy, friends. Mary is saved in the same way that every human being is saved. Her relationship to Christ in the spiritual realm is no different than any other human being. Next slide. Old ideas die hard, Desire of Ages 147. In saying to Mary that His hour had not yet come, Jesus was replying to her unspoken thought, to the expectation she cherished in common with her people. She hoped He would reveal Himself as the Messiah and take the throne of Israel. But the time had not come. Not as a king, but as a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, had Jesus accepted the lot of humanity. But though Mary had not a right conception of Christ's mission, she trusted Him implicitly. To this faith, Jesus responded. Do you remember what Mary said to the servants at the wedding feast? That's exactly right, Dennis. What's that, Nellie? Okay, that's right. That's right, Nellie. Jesus said to Mary, "Woman, my hour is not yet come." And then Mary turned to the servants and said, "Whatever He says to you, do it. Whatever He says to you, do it." Next slide. It took a long time for Mary to understand that Christ was her Savior. She felt that He would reign on David's throne and was deeply disappointed when she died, when He died. She was deeply disappointed when Christ died. While she birthed the Messiah and in that way was different than every human being, she still, like all mankind, would be saved only as she accepted Christ as her Savior and walked with Him by faith. I believe that's it, sweet. Next slide. Yeah. In closing today, my prayer is that we will respond to the angel just as Mary did in Luke chapter 1. When Mary said, "I am the servant of the Lord, be it unto me according to your word." May we in humility accept Christ's word as our guide day by day. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you today for the way in which you used Mary in this world. Thank you, Father, that through time, through the course of her life, she recognized Jesus as her Savior. We're thankful, Father, today that for the beautiful truths of the Bible that are very clear and very plain, that in the spiritual realm, Mary would be saved as she accepted Christ as her Savior by faith. We thank you for that great truth, and we're thankful today that as we go through this Sabbath, that we can accept Christ by faith. In his name we pray. Amen.